Good morning. Okay. Olivia Ann Ekberg is a freshman from Gilbert, Arizona. Olivia has spent the last 10 years of her, well, has spent 10 years of her life competing as a synchronized swimmer on the international level, having competed in 8 different countries. She will be speaking today on redefining the Olympic dream. She was the youngest athlete competing at the World Champions. She is currently coaching in Charlottesville, and her current plan is to complete her bachelor's degree in business and in English and pursue a career in communications. This introduction does not only suit her, but it doesn't do her justice. She is much more than just an Olympic swimmer, and she's a great friend of mine. So she not only exemplifies honor in both the classroom and outside of it, but let her tell you her story.
Thank you. I am so grateful and so humbled to be able to be here today and to share my story with you. I just want to express before I get started that I want to come on an equal level with everyone in this audience. I don't want to stand up here and put myself above anyone, and I don't want to be prideful in any way. I want to be vulnerable with you and share what I've learned through my experiences. And I really encourage you, if you feel like you want to be my friend, to come and share your story with me too, and I would love to hear it. When I was 8 years old, I started this thing called synchronized swimming. Most of you probably think of this image in your head with flower caps and side dives, or that SNL skit where men are sticking their hairy legs up in the air. Or some of you probably think of the sport in the Olympics where girls have jello in their hair and they wear makeup that doesn't come off underwater. And this is me. But for me, at 8 years old, it was dancing in the water, and I was entirely captivated. And I actually had a pretty large natural talent, and so I coupled that with intense determination, and for the next 10 years, I pursued one dream, the Olympic Games. And I got pretty close. When I was 12 years old, I made my first national team, and by the time I was 17, I was on the world championship team. I was on my way. This is me swimming at Worlds. I'm the one in the back. Thank you. Honestly, it was a dream. There was something about wearing USA on my back and holding that American flag at such a high level that brought the spirit just seeping through my bones. There was something about standing on the top of the podium with my hand over my heart, watching the American flag rise higher than the other countries, listening to the national anthem being played just for me. There is something about swimming in that arena, swimming with these girls, with that flag on my cap. There is something about watching my friends and teammates, the mixed duet, win world championships, upsetting Russia in Russia for the first time since 1997. These were our reactions. There is something about being on this team that made me believe that I could go farther and be better than I ever thought was possible. And it brought the greatest joy to my life. But with 10 years of dedication to a single thing, it also brought my greatest pain and my hardest lessons. Shortly after returning to my relocated home in California after World Championships, I began to experience some health problems. It started with a migraine and escalated all the way to multiple seizures, which landed me in an ambulance racing towards the hospital alone. My mom was a state away, my host parents were unreachable at the time, and my coaches were gone. I remember lying in that ambulance, watching the trees blur above me as we raced along the highway, feeling the ET next to me trying to stick an IV in my shaking arm, and feeling the tears pour down my face and pull around the oxygen tubes that were in my nose. I was tired, I craved heaven, and I missed my mom more than anything. Fast forward a few weeks, and I find myself back home in Arizona with my family trying to find some answers. We ran countless tests and procedures and didn't find anything. Every single test, every result came back clean. We ran an EEG because I was still seizing multiple times a day, but there was nothing going on in my brain. Eventually, we were faced with the words conversion disorder. Basically, my brain was making my body sick. After all the emotional turmoil that I had experienced over 10 years of a perfectionistic sport, after pushing myself, after trying to obtain a standard of performance that was too high, my thought process was making my body sick. And so I was told I needed to learn how to think again. And so I quit the team. I gave up my chance of being the junior world soloist that summer, of going to the Olympic qualifier, two more world championships, and an Olympic Games. And I came home and I tried to adjust to the vast unknown of normal life, but there was nothing normal about it. I found myself a counselor who would later change my life, and I tried to teach myself how to think again. But I was still shaking multiple times a day, and my thoughts escalated so dramatically and brought a darkness so intense it was a fight to get on my feet every morning. I couldn't grasp the concept of being imperfect. I thought if I was perfect, I would never be criticized, I would never be judged, I would never fail, and everyone would like me. And that concept of being imperfect made me wake up neck deep in shame every morning. One thing after another seemed to happen to make everything worse, and I wasn't in a place emotionally or physically to handle any extra weight. My body was reacting to all the stress physically, and I sank deeper and deeper. There were no words to describe the excruciating loneliness and darkness I felt closing in around me, drowning me. Eventually, it was too much. I was tired, I was exhausted, and I was angry. I was especially angry at God. I thought that he had abandoned me. I thought I had seen him walk away from me. I didn't believe I was worthy of his love, and I didn't think I would ever feel the Spirit again until I was perfect. When that happened, I felt the war inside of my heart go silent. I didn't think I would miss the everyday battle, but I did. As soon as I denied God, as soon as I walked away from him, I went completely numb. I felt a new kind of darkness, one that didn't have joy occasionally shining through. There was a solid wall built around my heart, and I couldn't feel any joy, nor did I even try. I didn't go to church for a while, and then I started going again because that's what perfect people do. And I would kind of pray, but I would mostly just yell at a God I didn't believe in my car. But what I didn't know was going back to church and going every week, because I was perfect, right, was putting the Spirit in a position to get closer and closer to my heart. And that's it. That's what happened. There was no miracle. Lightning didn't strike me from the heavens. God didn't slap his existence across my face. It was so small. It was just the act of me going to church and letting the Spirit come closer and closer. And my mom, the greatest influence I had, held on to me for dear life. And that's what brought me back. Eventually, I was sitting in a chapel in this tiny town in Southern Virginia, and I felt a prompting to bear my testimony, but I didn't have anything to say. I was getting closer, but I couldn't testify at anything. But I hadn't felt a prompting for 9 months, and so I acted on it because I didn't want it to go away. And I stood up, and these are the words that came out of my mouth. I know God. I believe in God, and I want God, and that's enough for me. That statement completely changed my life. That day was September 4th, 2016, and that's when I felt God again for the first time in my life. I felt something, and I was completely new. The story doesn't end there. It's still a fight for me to get out of bed every morning. I still battle perfectionism. I still wake up neck deep in shame. I still don't feel like I'm worthy of anything, and I still have moments where I feel like I'm drowning and I can't keep my head above water anymore. But this time, I'm doing it with God. And this time, I'm grateful that He loves me enough and trusts me enough to give me hard things. So you're probably wondering, what does this have to do with honor? It's Honor Week. I believe honor is learning to begin again every single day. Honor is learning to be your best self amidst the fires of refinement. And so I want to teach you one of the greatest things I learned through this whole ordeal, through my whole story. I want to convince you all that you have the capacity to be Olympians, and I want to redefine the Olympic dream. There is a fire so bright, so dedicated and passionate within every Olympic hopeful. They wake up every morning and run towards the Olympic Games as fast as they can. That same fire resides within each one of us. Within every Olympic-type dream, there is an Olympic-type hope, an Olympic-type effort that will result eventually in an Olympic-type victory. My dream at 12 years old was to go to the Olympics, and so I woke up and I trained 60 hours a week and fought as hard as I could to get there until God changed my course. My dream now at 18 years old is to be happy, to be real and authentic, to let myself be seen. And I wake up every day, join my hand with God, and fight for that dream with the same vigor and intensity that I fought to become an Olympian. You can do the same thing. Wake up and fight. Don't be discouraged if your dream changes course, because that's okay. It's okay to change our mind and to redefine what it is we're fighting for. There is immense power in waking up and beginning again, and being okay with starting over. Accepting the darkness, the numbness, rock bottom, the fire, the failure. There is power in darkness, for that is where we will find our will to keep going, to keep fighting, and to run towards God as fast as we can. If we join our dreams with the hand of God, my friends, it is guaranteed that we will come out victorious. So start now. Take a half step forward. Even if you shake, even if your voice trembles, even if tears fall, move forward. Begin again, begin new. Recognize the power that comes when you use your broken pieces to be whole. Don't be afraid. Don't stop. Keep running, keep fighting, keep being imperfect, and start lighting the fire for your Olympic dream. Thank you.
Take the time I have left to live, and I'll for my fellow men, and I'll live in praise of that moment when I was able to begin again. I will start anew, I will make amends, and I'll make quite certain that the story ends on a note of hope, on a strong amen, and I'll thank the world and remember when I was able to begin again.
Thank you so much, Anna and Abby. And thank you, Olivia, for that amazing story. It's a true privilege to be able to stand before you today and introduce a former student and friend, who, and my daughter's best friend, who has become my own friend, Bethany Anderson. Bethany graduated in 2007 with her mother at the same time and received the recognition of being Southern Virginia's first mother and daughter graduating pair. Following Bethany's senior year, she was introduced to social work by her mission president in the Utah Provo Mission. Following her graduation from Southern Virginia, she finished a master's degree in social work at Brigham Young University. She then accepted a job as a family therapist and community health in Arizona. As a licensed clinical social worker and registered play therapist, Bethany specializes in sand tray therapy and now works at the Anasazi Foundation, the oldest operating wilderness therapy program for troubled teens and adults that utilizes the Tonto National Forest in Arizona. She considers SVU, as I do as well, to be her home of the heart. Bethany Anderson.
I feel like I don't really have adequate words to express what I feel being back here on this campus. I'm gonna have a cryy moment as I try to articulate. This place shaped me. The experiences that I had here, more than my high school years, more than the time that I spent in my home state, shaped me into who I was. The people that I met are actually still a part of my life. Friends that I continue to travel far distances to meet up with. At the feet of the professors, I learned how to think critically. And I learned how to enjoy learning and communicate effectively. And I took a moment yesterday when we got on campus and started just walking around and was just touched by how much those the essence of SVU is still intact. This environment that you guys are existing in and marinating in right now is the same environment that was here 15 years ago when I started school. So it really is a privilege to be back. I have to say, I remember sitting in this room listening to Kendi Nielsen talk about schools in Africa, and I was like, whoa, she was a student that was here right when this started. She is one of the ancestors of SVU. And then over Christmas, I met a current student here, and she used the same word to describe me. And I was like, excuse me, ancestor. That seems a little intense. But then I thought about it, and I was like, you know what? If that is going to give me some street cred to talk to you today about what life is like after college, or if that's going to allow me to step on a soapbox and do the back in my day sort of speeches, then I'll take it. I really, really do love this place, and I am honored to be a part of some of that groundwork, some of those days. early days. Here we are at Honor Week. Gosh, why does SVU even have an honor code? Why does it matter? Why should we follow it? How does that impact the rest of our lives? I feel like I have a lot of opinions about those questions, but perhaps we can answer those questions by answering a few other questions. Like, what are the value of my experiences? What is the impact of an environment, and how do laws and boundaries fit into the whole mix? George Bernard Shaw said, life isn't about finding yourself, life is about creating yourself. And I love that because it emphasizes that we have power within ourselves to choose. You and I exist right now. The past is actually just memories at this point. The future is not even here yet. We only have right now, in the present. That's where our power lives, that's where our reality is. And so the process of gathering information through our senses, feeling things in response to what our thoughts are, and what our actions are, those experiences are what shape us. With thoughts, with new experiences, we actually form new neural pathways in our brain. And so basically our thoughts and our feelings directly do impact the way that we behave and the way that we, kind of like the pathways that we continue to follow and act on in the future. And over time, our repeated actions actually form our character. So our mindsets, how do they develop? I believe it's through our experiences. Looking at it through more of a developmental lens, we have this guy named Eric Erickson who created or established these stages of development. And we know from his research that in the first year of life, the task of that infant is, he titles it trust versus mistrust. So basically, you're figuring out or you're learning through your experiences whether the world is a place that you can trust and whether the people in it are those that you can rely on and depend on. So if you think about it, babies, totally helpless, drooling little things that are, they cry because they're hungry. They cry because they need their diaper changed. And if in response to those cries, a loving caregiver comes and provides support and fulfills that need, that baby is learning through those experiences that the world is a place that you can trust, that I can rely on the people around me to meet my needs. But if the opposite happens, through neglect, if that baby's needs are ignored, they develop a belief that they can't trust. And then that actually does persist throughout our lives. That core experience does persist. So how do we change negative or unhealthy mindsets or even negative core beliefs? I think it comes through having new experiences. Like it was mentioned, I work at a wilderness therapy program. So imagine like a wilderness forest full of a bunch of hippies that are eating rice and lentils out of little cups and hiking around, carving spoons, and basically everything they need for survival is on their back. They create a pack out of a poncho and paracord. That, and then imagine like a group of angry teenagers with them. That's what the wilderness program is. It's basically taking teenagers that are struggling and putting them in a new environment with loving and supportive, healthy relationships in the form of these trail walkers who are the direct care staff that work there. And there's an adult program, there's a teenage program. These people stay out there for like 9 weeks on average. It's kind of an open-ended program. But typical profile of someone who comes to Anasazi is someone who's experiencing a lot of conflict in their home. Their parents and them aren't getting along. Usually they're failing school. Usually they're engaging in some level of substance abuse or other risky behaviors. And a lot of times, and I would actually probably say all the time, there's an experience of low sense of self-worth. Like they don't like themselves and their behaviors are kind of manifesting that. So why would putting them in the woods make a difference? That seems a little odd. It does because when that kid is encountering a new environment, all of their stuff is going to come up. Their thinking patterns, their behaviors are going to manifest themselves in that new environment, and then it allows them to confront their issues head on. So when they are faced with, you either got to hike to the next water source or not have water, which, you know, is one of those life things. Natural consequences, right? You learn, oh, wow, I guess I do have choice. I guess I do have power over my actions in this situation. When it's in a rainstorm and the band is looking up at this huge mountain that they have to climb because that's where they need to get their new food pack, they learn that they can do hard things. When they accomplish these tasks that just seem so beyond them, it builds that confidence and that belief in their capability. We also do like primitive fire out there. If anyone's ever made fire using like one match, you think you're pretty hardcore. Try just sticks, like only sticks that you gather from the environment, and then there's like a piece of string that then, or paracord, that you do a bow drill out of. Making fire from just sticks is a powerful experience, and everyone that goes there, that's one of the first things that they learn during the first 4 days of their journey. And then after you made the fire, imagine digging into that food pack, pulling out those rice and lentils, and cooking yourself a meal to eat. That unlocks the power of self-reliance and realizing that, I guess that you're stronger than you ever thought you were. And so those experiences, in addition to having, like I said, those trail walkers there that are providing love and support, they are also there to point out greatness. They're there saying, hey, I noticed that you did this. I noticed that you are saying this to your peers. That's awesome. They're pointing out the greatness, what we call the seeds of greatness, in each of those individuals. And so by someone other than their parents recognizing how awesome they are, they start to believe in their own worthiness. Could someone have just told these kids, you're capable, you're strong, everyone loves you? Yeah, they could have. In fact, I think their parents were probably doing that beforehand. But that's not enough. It doesn't cut it. We have to actually feel it, and we feel those things through the experiences that we have. I feel, as I mentioned before, that the experiences that I had at SVU were very formative. The experiences that you guys are having right now are shaping the way that you think and behave. You're essentially laying out like the mental and emotional groundwork for how you're going to respond to situations in the future. And by choosing to put yourself in this unique environment, you're exposing yourself to certain types of people and certain types of experiences. When I came, I was at the precious age of 17 years old. It was so weird coming away on my own and having this experience. But I came the first year that SVU had switched from being SVC to now a university. And so at the time, there were 400 students, which for me was an upgrade because in Paonia, Colorado, where I graduated high school, there's only 200 students. So I thought, this is great. I still know everyone. And it allowed me actually to continue some of those extracurricular hobbies that I'd been involved in previously. So you are in a small environment, you can do everything. So I did. I did sports, I did choir, I did theater, I did student government, you name it. But I also was in a place where I was surrounded by people that had a very pioneering mentality. With 400 students, you can imagine that things looked a little different. I go out on campus and I'm like, wow, things have changed, this is cool. I was here during the pre-Jonesy's era. The Landrum was our institute building. The tile on the court over there, it was like sport court tile that when you bounced your basketball, it like shot off in 45 degree angles. This room itself had like dirt floor. And I think before, well, because it was a barn, so before it got converted, there was even like a random hand cart that was hanging out in the corner that Sister Knight had used for Education Week. And so I'm telling you, there's no football team at that point. No, not all the different programs that exist maybe in a larger university, but I was surrounded by individuals that were motivated to create what wasn't there. One of my friends wanted an a cappella group, so she gathered up some female singers and they started what was called 7 a.m., which then transitioned over time to become what's now the Fading Point. A bunch of funny guys my freshman year decided they wanted to do improv comedy. So they got together and created Shenanigans. The year that I did student government, Christy Gibbons and I worked closely together, and we started the first SVU Idol, which is kind of cool that it still exists. Now I'm looking at your calendar, I'm like, oh, cool. I was surrounded by, I was living in a community of doers. And those experiences definitely shaped the way that I think. I actually was reflecting on this recently and realized that the way that I interact with my environment now in my community in Arizona is from my roots here. I see a need and I go and I fill it. Living in SVU land, you learn that you can't wait for life to be handed to you on a silver platter. You have the ingredients around you, go and make that gourmet meal. Another George Bernard Shaw quote, props to this guy one more time. He says, the people who get on in this world are the people who get up and look for the circumstances they want. And if they can't find them, make them. Experiences shape us. The environments we're in influence us. But it's the laws and the boundaries that exist in those environments that establish the tone of the environment. Laws and boundaries are necessary. I think SVU is a special place because of the honor code. It was really cool to go online after I had been invited to speak to go and look and see what is actually the honor code right now. What are the words that are on the screen? And I was really impressed with how succinct it is now. Bam, principles. This is what we live, this is what we believe. These are the values that we think are important and that we are committing to uphold. And I think that experience of having a large group of people committed to the same values is what creates this environment. An environment where the spirit is present. An environment where you can leave things lying around and not be scared out of your mind that they're not going to be there when you come back to them. These values, or a group of people invested in obtaining or maintaining a certain set of values, is cultivating that environment that creates that safety, and then is a place for learning. I know in reading those things and what the honor code has, those are high values. Like living those things, I think essentially is kind of like a science experiment. This microcosm of SVU land is like a science experiment to figure out what things work and what things don't. You're also in that exploration state of like, who am I and what do I want to do with my life and what are my talents and skills? So you really are doing a lot of experimenting, but I think in terms of choosing to live in honor code, you're experimenting with how that feels to embrace high values. And by doing it, you experience the fruit of it. You feel what it feels like to have inner congruence. You feel what it feels like to have people trust you. You feel the satisfaction that comes from producing honest work. You feel that increased confidence and inner peace. And that is the experience that you take with you. That then, if you like what you feel, you repeat that in a different setting, in the new place that you go next. You can still choose to live by those same values because those values are actually eternal principles that have consequences that come from living them. I think that that's the beautiful thing. There's laws and there's boundaries, but there's always a consequence. Some consequences are positive, some are negative. Some come immediately, some come over time. But essentially, experiencing what it feels like is what's powerful. But the honor part, I was thinking about this. I think you could argue that the values that are in the honor code are honorable. I think that that word is more about, less about the values and more about the fact that you committed to something. You said, I will do this. To be honorable means that you will do what you say. The things that you say you're gonna do, you follow through on. I think the attitude that, you know, personal credibility is kind of what that comes down to. I think the attitude that we have towards the laws and the boundaries that are in our life matters. How we interact with those laws and the boundaries produce a different experience. You can resist laws, rules, boundaries. You can resist them, and that will provide a certain experience. Or you can embrace them, and that will provide a certain experience. And I actually think that it takes more energy to resist something that you said you were going to do. When you resist, kicking against the pricks is the word from the scriptures that we, you know, like what resistance, it actually is, it uses up a lot of energy. But I think more or less the experience that you have interacting with the honor code here is gonna shape a mentality that you have toward other structures that come in your life. In your first job, there's gonna be laws and boundaries in place. How will you react to that? Will you see them as a limitation? Or will you see them as the constructs that are creating a certain type of environment, an environment that is upholding the values that that company thinks are important? Freedom is not the absence of laws and boundaries. Freedom is not, I'm just gonna do what I want. Freedom is actually a consequence of how you use your gift of choice. For example, I think that we actually are more free when we understand and operate within the laws and boundaries that exist around us. You could see this in music. Someone who understands music theory, chord progressions, chord structures, the rules of music, someone who understands that is more free to create beautiful music versus someone who doesn't really understand it and they are just picking and choosing whatever notes they want to on that piano. In the context of our communities, the more I understand and follow the laws and boundaries and structures of my community, the more free I am to live my own life and pursue my independent interests, because I'm not being burdened by restrictive fines or jail time. I think embracing the commitments that we've made and creating opportunities is a way that creating the opportunities in our life and expanding our freedoms relates to our attitudes of how we approach the circumstances and environments and places that we are. We are under no obligation to be the person that we were 5 minutes ago. I love that. I love that in nature we are shown that new beginnings happen all the time. Every day the sun rises. Every day we get a new start. Every moment we have power. Because again, the past doesn't exist anymore. It's just memories. The future isn't here anymore. We have right now. And the more that we can focus our energy into that present moment, the more power that we have in our life, in our experiences, and over the way that we feel. With that precious gift of choice, we can have new beginnings every day. We can choose to have new experiences. We can put ourselves in different environments, and we can operate in a new way with the laws and boundaries that exist. May we all feel empowered to be the architects of our own lives. Thank you.